Welcome to Draw One Last Breath Horror Podcast. My name's Matt.
I'm Butch.
I'm Jody Paul.
Welcome to episode 118. On this episode, we have been to the movies to watch Violent Night. In our Something to Scream About, we do our favourite jump scares, and also our movie from the vault is 1981's Dead and Buried. How the devil are you doing, guys?
Well, I wish I was dead and buried.
Just, we'll get on to that later.
We can arrange that if you want.
Oh, it's been another long 2 weeks. Lots of stuff going on. I mean, wrap presents last night, so that's a Billy bonus. Sent your boys presents gone into the ether for next episode. We will be opening presents live on air. Yes,
that's because what everybody wants to see on a podcast.
I mean, you know, who knows? Maybe if we do a clean, non-edited podcast, then we'll put it on YouTube. Maybe no, maybe might we'll see.
See how the magic happens.
I'll give it a go. Never edited a video before. I think you should give it a go, Matt, editing a video. You must know
it. It would be quite easy, to be fair, I think.
Right. Cool. What about what have you been watching? What's been going on, lads? Come on.
Well, I'm going to go first this week.
Ooh, he's watched something this week, Paul.
I finally have watched a movie. I've watched a couple of movies, actually. I probably should save this for a further on movie from the vault, really. But I sat down and I was like, I'm really interested. I've picked this one up at work all the time, and I've been intrigued by the cover. Because it's got like, it's a really like a hand-drawn kind of cover from, I think it's on 101 Films, and it's like a hand-drawn like cover, and they're like punks on the front. And it's always drawn me in, and it's called Class of 1984. And I was fucking blown away, loved it. But maybe I shouldn't have said that, because it's just crazy. It's a bit of a teacher comes to a bad school, but the school is like, on its knees, and some crazy shit goes on, and then there's a kind of second act or third act, would you say, that happens that is quite harrowing, which I didn't expect to come.
And you said it starred the great Michael J. Fox as well.
Yeah, I literally couldn't believe my eyes when I think actually somebody told me this a while back that he was in it, and I couldn't believe. I thought he was going to come on for like 2 minutes. He wasn't. He was in the film like a proper character, and he's chubby. It's so weird.
Chubby Fox.
So weird. So strange. But yeah, that was really good. I watched that. I also have watched Mr. Travis Stevens' new movie, A Wounded Fawn, on Shudder.
That was a Fright Fest one, wasn't it?
Was it a Fright Fest? We clashed with something that we went and saw. So I'm glad it came to Shudder. It was an interesting watch. Very strange, bit trippy. Very strange, but I can't really talk about it because it just spoil things. And I'll let you guys maybe.
You saying this is worth a watch then?
I don't know really. I don't know what you guys think because it is very, it's out there. It's very trippy. There's lots of meaning in it, and yeah, I don't really want to talk too much about it because I don't want to go into spoiler territory. I'd rather maybe you go and watch it. It's only like about an hour and a half, so.
Okay. All right, cool.
Maybe go watch it. But the visuals are pretty fucking crazy. What about you guys? What have you been watching?
Well, I'll go next.
No, go on.
Repeating what you guys have watched. I did watch Run, Sweetheart, Run, which I did enjoy. Really, really thought that was a good one. Really interestingly shot. Not really sure. It's like almost like a creature feature. It's fucking. It is good that Pilau is fucking fantastic as a bad guy. I think it's fucking great. It's a really clever movie. The Wonder, not so clever. Quite bleak. She's obviously fantastic, but again, I had to watch it in about three sittings. It was a hard watch, to be honest. Did not really get on with it too much.
Is that the one you watched, Jordy Paul?
Yeah, I agree. It's long and it takes its time to get where it's gonna go. So yeah. But the performances in it, though, like Florence Pugh is amazing in it. So, but yeah, it's quite a slow film and dreary.
Going to take more than that, mate.
And so. Irish, so slow, dreary, and Irish.
Thanks for doing homework, boys.
But I tell you what, one I did another one I really did enjoy. I watched Troll. It's just popped up on
Netflix. Yeah, I watched that as well.
Yeah.
Forgot honestly, about that one.
Was it Norwegian, another Norwegian, sort of goes into more of the fantasy sort of realm. So much fun, though.
It's very similar to the other one that came out, though.
Troll Hunter,
yeah.
It looks exactly the same as Troll Hunter, so is it not?
Pretty much.
But it's not. It's like the last of a dying breed sort of thing. So it gets some quite emotion in the end, but ultimately it's like a troll it's fantasy, traipsing around Norwegian, like, you know, destruction and them trying to stop it. It's like... it's Norway's Godzilla at the end of the day.
I've never seen so many little kind of captions be typed out the top of where they are and what time it is. Literally every fucking scene. It's like telling you what time it was and where.
I did watch all of The Walking Dead last few episodes. So smashed it, put the time in. Totally worth it. So happy that that I've sort of come to a nice end. Yeah, some really fucking good bits, man. And like some of the evolving zombies, it's sort of we're going into Romero territory. It's quite interesting where they're going with it. Anyway, Geordie Paul.
Okay, well, I watched some absolute dross this week, just through just putting the TV on and just not being able to choose. So there was some absolute shite. So I think we'll go through it. It's not really a horror film, but I watched it the other day. Equilibrium. Have you seen Equilibrium with Christian Bale?
Oh, yeah. The kind of Matrix kind of thing.
I did not get on with that one.
I went to the cinema to see it. I don't mind it. So it's a bit crap, and it hasn't really aged very well. But yeah, it was on. I then watched... this was last night, there was nothing else on. I just sat there and let me brain bleed out my ears. Resident Evil, the final chapter. Now, having only seen the first two Resident Evil films, this made no sense whatsoever, but it was absolutely awful. Just the way it was shot, acted, I'm like, ugh. I don't know why I watched it, but I did. It was a horror film, so I thought it was relevant. I caught The Exorcist again, so I think it's the third time I've seen it this year.
Fucking hell. Scott.
Yeah, it was on the horror channel, so I just watched it. It's fantastic. Still, just every time you watch it, you notice something different, so it's brilliant. I watched a little short on Shudder called White Girl. It was like 12 minutes long, so I just put it on my lunch. It's okay. Didn't really do much. Left more questions and answers, but it was quite gory towards the end. So definitely worth 12 minutes of your time. And then a special place in my heart is reserved for the original of this, but Willow. Oh, my God. I fucking love the original Willow. And the Disney Plus series is ticking all the boxes so far. So, yeah, really, really
Although,
good.
Although, I've watched it as well, all three episodes. And it's getting a right bashing online. It really is.
Why?
I don't know. Loads of people are just coming online saying it's the worst thing they've watched. It's just the storyline's bad. The acting's bad. And I mean, I don't know if they're watching a different Willow TV series, but I really like it. I'm really loving it. And
I think all the cast are really amazing. Good, isn't it? I think it's the bouncing off age quite well. All the chemistry's quite there. I don't know. I'm loving it, mate. So boo all the internet. Boo. What do you know?
The special effects are good, though. I thought practical. They were really good.
Yeah.
Some of the characters.
I think trolls in the next episode as well, so that'll be good.
The problem is everybody just bashes it early. It's like it's three episodes in. It's like everyone bashes stuff before it even gets going. You've got to give it a little bit of time to breathe. But there you go. Anyway, I really liked it anyway.
So that was it. That was it for me.
All right, then let's get on to some fucking news now then. I'm going to kick this bad boy off. I'm not going to go too much. I think I'm going to steal one of Matt's, which I'm basically trying not to do. Yellow Jackets Season 2 will premiere in March 2023. Now, I don't know if anyone caught that this year. That was probably one of my best and favourite TV shows of the year. Fucking fantastic. Group of girls, soccer team, sort of crashes in the woods. Lots of weird paranormal shit happens.
Football team.
It crosses like almost like two time barriers, them stuck in the woods and them of age. There's some weird shit that must have happened and weird shit that they're trying to leave behind. It's very, very good. Christina Ricci starring, El Pinnell. It's just fucking fantastic. Well worth a watch. And I'm very looking forward to checking out season two. I'm going to leave that news because I reckon that one's yours. I watched a trailer, Infinity Pool. Mia Goth, Alexander Skarsgård enter the twisted world of Brandon Cronenberg. You must like the sound of that, Jordy Paul. Did you see the trailer?
I watched it today and it looks fucked up.
Yeah, man. It looks really, really good, man. Just like maybe a death gone wrong and like doppelgangers, you know, body horror. There's some good shit that's sort of like popping up. Mia Goth is obviously absolutely smashing it. So looking forward to seeing her into something else. That usually comes out about January the 27th in theatres.
Exciting. Will it be in our theatres? Probably not.
Well, if it's as good as Possessor, then I'm in. So.
Yeah. Matt, go on, you go.
Obviously, I've just got one bit of news that we've already kind of talked about previously. But Mike Flanagan is leaving Netflix. He's done. So they cancelled Midnight Club, which was a shame. Which I wasted my life watching that program. Actually quite liked it, but they're not finishing it. Maybe they might go and finish it on Amazon, but be a bit weird. But yeah, so he's tied up all his kind of stuff with them and he's going over to Amazon Prime.
But do you know
what project? Have you heard what he's doing on Amazon Prime?
Yeah, have you heard the project?
Yep.
Now, I watched the McConaughey Alba one. Okay, everyone's at a moan. Okay, it's not the book. But if they do it properly, because this would be interesting, The Dark Tower, if they do it properly, really dive into it, I'm sure it's going to be awesome. But what I want him to do is The Stand. I want to.
That would be cool. I would love that.
Because he banged on about it, wasn't it? It was like going to be like 5 movies or something stupid. Bring it on.
He could flesh that out so good and the characters would be awesome. Just use the cast that he always uses. That would just be splendid. Perfectly splendid.
I never saw the new TV series. Like, did it star Whoopi Goldberg as Mother Abigail?
Yeah, pass. James Marsden and stuff, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Sort of came and went without really having doing anything,
did it? It's weird. We sell it at work quite a lot. Like, people buy it, so it must be worth something. I don't know. Never seen it, but.
Weird one.
As long as there's double denim in it, I don't mind.
Cool. I've got a couple of bits then. So you stole two of them. So the Flanagan and Infinity Pool. But the Winnie the Pooh horror remake film that's coming out, because all the rights have come up. So the same company are going to do a Bambi horror film, basically where Bambi takes revenge on whoever killed her mother. Sounds mental, but apparently the guy who's doing it has also said that he's got his eyes on doing a horror film about Peter Pan as well, so expect more Disney horror films to come out. Thought it was funny. Matt, I thought you might know this, but Candyland, that we watched at Fright Fest, which we all thought was really, really good, is getting released in cinemas on the 6th of January. Now, whether that's Main Street cinemas or it's just limited, I don't know, and if it's in America or whatever, but it's getting a theatrical release, so...
Because that means it must be coming out. Like, they must have a distributor. So, hopefully...
Awesome.
That'd be quality.
They won't see that big growler, though, in the corner of the screen.
Well, I bet you any money that's cut. Bet you.
Maybe. That was just reserved for us at Fright Fest.
What we watched was probably purely uncut. I can imagine that some of that's probably been cut back.
Guaranteed. But regardless, it's a fucking brilliant film.
I'll watch it.
So, yeah, definitely check that out. And then the last bit of news, I've got Peter Jackson was doing interviews around. He's got some World War II documentary coming out. But they started asking him about his past projects and releases and stuff. And he admitted that he, behind the scenes, while he's doing the World War II stuff, he experimented with all of his back catalogue to see if the restoring World War II footage to try and get it a bit more HD. And he experimented with his back catalogue and it came out looking brilliant. So next year should see the release in 4K or HD or whatever of Bad Taste,
Meet the Feebles,
Raised Dead, and Meet the Feebles.
Right. Well, that secures one pick for next year. We will do Brain Dead as a fucking 4K.
We do Brain Dead every week.
Yeah. But yeah, I own Brain Dead. I got my only copy of Brain Dead is this at the moment. Lovely little VHS. So. I really need an updated version.
Well, there you go. It's on its way, so I should look at it. But yeah, that was all my news.
I got one more bit, which I don't know if you mentioned this last episode or not, Matt. And we watched it in the week, and you sent me Cocaine Bear.
Oh shit! Yeah, we haven't talked about
Cookie
that.
Bear.
Right, I basically texted you, didn't I? I said, "Bear, check. Cocaine, check. I'm in. Bear, cocaine, bear."
I mean, where did we watch? Where did the trailer pop up again?
It was on Violent Night.
It was before Violent Night. They actually put it out, so it might get a cinema release. Cocaine Bear.
It's directed by Elizabeth Banks.
Oh mate, this is going to be fucking.
It's definitely
stupid.
Coming out in cinemas.
Great. Okay, anyone listening, go and watch the trailer for Cocaine Bear and enjoy.
Based on a true story. That's what I love.
Can you imagine when they went in to pitch the movie? Right. A big bear does cocaine. Money.
Money, 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 money.
I mean, hopefully the trailer doesn't kill it, like it spoiled it, but the trailer does make the film.
It's a long trailer. It looks like it shows all the good bits, but... Never know.
Awesome. Is that all the news we got?
I think so, yeah. Plenty of news for this week.
Loads. All right, well, let's get on to our main review.
You ain't driving, are you?
I steer a little, but the reindeer do most of the work.
This is my fourth year as a Santa. How about you?
I started the whole damn thing.
Christmas!
We decided that you could have one gift.
Early.
What is it?
That is a direct hotline to Santa Claus himself.
I can talk to Santa.
All right, revelers. Welcome to your worst Christmas ever.
Let's go!
Okay, this episode's main review is Violent Night. It's where when a group of mercenaries attack the estate of a wealthy family, Santa Claus must step in to save the day and Christmas. Starring David Harbour, John Leguizamo? Did I say that right?
We'll see.
It's been a lot. John Leguizamo from from Panic Terror among among a lot of others.
I'm just going to make you say it. What's that guy called again?
David Harbour plays Santa Claus. There we go. It's sort of like, you know, an action thriller comedy with some, and it's set at Christmas and it's got a lot of uber violence. It's done by the producers of Nobody. And it's just a why not go and watch it. It's fucking fun. What do you guys think, Paul?
I fucking loved this film, guys. I don't know if it's just because I'm feeling a bit shit at the minute with Christmas, but oh my God, I expected it. I loved the trailer when I saw it. I thought the trailer was really good, and I just loved it from start to finish. I thought it was hilarious. I thought it was gory. I thought it was mental. I thought it was quite sentimental in places. And I honestly thoroughly enjoyed it. I want a sequel. Violent Night 2.
Oh, there probably will be one.
Hopefully. Oh my God, it was just the right kind of stupid, but yeah, loved it. Yeah,
it was dumb. Matt?
David Harbour was brilliant. The rest of it, I could have give or take it, mate. There's some good bits in it, but yeah, I was just like, I think it kind of like didn't really know where it wanted to be. It's like 1 minute, it's like starts off like, oh, this is quite different. It's like a bit bad Santa-y in places. And I thought it was going to be like that all the way through, like quite a lot of like intense kind of really, really like near the bone jokes and stuff like that. But it didn't really go there. It was like, does it want to be gory? Does it want to be funny? Does it want to be sentimental? Does it want to be, and it's put out by Universal, wasn't it? So I was just like, it was all right. David Harbour was brilliant. And there's some scenes that I'm sure we'll talk about that I thought were really good. But for me, it was just a bit middle of the road, mate. And I've seen Nobody. Nobody is fucking amazing. Absolutely amazing. You guys seen Nobody?
I haven't.
Oh, mate, you both need to go out. It's your homework this week. Go and watch Nobody. Please.
I will try it. It's on the list. But I'm sort of like halfway between the both of you. I mean, I thought it was a good bit of fun. I like David Harbour was fucking fantastic, but the rest of the cast, including, unfortunately, you know, the legend that is Babs, is just it's not another Babs. Lest we forget, it's Beverly D'Angelo, the classic European Vacation, not Babs. I call her Babs. Anyway, but it's sort of just like, it's a good bit of fun. And I was, there was a point in the movie where I was just like, oh fuck, it's just a little bit too long. Oh, okay, fair enough. I'll give you, I would like to have a round of applause for that kill. So yeah, it sort of follows like Santa being a bit moody, puking on people, being drunk, not really giving a shit. It's sort of gone with a nice hot, different turn on what Santa is. He's a fucking Viking at one stage. There's a rich family who we don't really give a shit about, this snobby richy family.
I think that's one of the reasons why I disliked it. I know you're not meant to really like them, but I just didn't feel for any of the characters. I didn't even feel like, maybe that's what you're meant to feel. I didn't even feel like they were family.
But he wasn't doing it for them. He was doing it for the little girl.
Yeah, you know, it's a Christmas Trudy film. Sort of follows her, and it's sort of, they're trying to take some money, and Santa, for some reason, loses man, just starts kicking the shit out of everyone. And we learn that he was once a Viking who had a hammer. So there's some quite interesting fucking kills and deaths, and definitely some... that you see some of it's in the trailer, but it's just like that sort of producer, it's ass kicky, but it was a little bit, there was a moment in it that were just like a little bit slow.
Jesus,
sorry oh Paul. Happy Christmas.
Can we right tonight, home merry fucking whore, can we talk about the tribute to Home Alone?
Yeah, but it was,
I thought was genius. Oh my god, Matt, what? So there's a little mention at the start about how she's watched Home Alone and she does a little scream thing and it's all very funny. And then actually she gets to reenact it in the house. And it's so funny because they're like, she sets booby traps for them, which don't really work. But then...
Actually, come to think of it, now I'm thinking of it, that bit, the stair bit was fucking pretty good.
Oh my God, where it breaks and spoilers, spoilers, the nail goes through his chin, man. Oh, it's just... Oh, I loved it. I absolutely loved it. And then, like, obviously the nods to Die Hard 2 with the relief team coming, and, you know, even he says Die Hard on Blu-ray when he's having one of the fights. So it's obviously very, very self-aware. Yeah. But the grip kills, a star to the face, then it sets his skull alight. I thought you would love that.
That was great. There were some great moments of gore and special effects and kills and stuff. And don't let me talk about, you know, Death by Chimney, because that is just fucking one of the best kills of the year for me.
That was up there. I think that was one thing that I thought, like, was very, very good.
But, like, the stuff of Home Alone was good and gory and clever, but we kind of got that from Better Watch Out. So it's sort of almost been done before the poke at the Home Alone, which is not
a
problem.
And it's funny that
it is funny.
Better Watch Out is also a Universal movie.
Mm.
So they're sort of, by the same people.
They're sort of playing that trope over and over again, which is fine because it's funny. But like, why not? But and some of the kills and some of the violence and the way you get to see that is great. But I don't know. There was just bits of it. I was just like, I don't really give a shit. Don't care.
Yeah, that's not to mention, like, the dad is an absolute tosser.
Oh yeah, I get that.
But yeah, he's still painted as a good bloke. Oh, he's a good bloke, really. Well, no, none of this would happen.
And the win, and the, you know, the fact that did I want Santa to win? Maybe I just want Santa to win. They need to be, you know, maybe I just needed to be, to give a shit a little bit, but I know they needed a reason. And the scene with the hammer was fantastic. Like, all the kills were brilliant. But I'm not saying it's a John Wick far-fetched moment, but where the fuck does all these people suddenly come from just to set up like him wielding this hammer? They just, I don't know, that's been done a lot, like where they literally come out of nowhere and it's suddenly like he must have killed about what, 50 people in that fucking small hut somehow. Where are they all hiding? Where was he hiding? I don't know. Maybe I was being a bit of a humbug.
But, definitely. He's Scrooge's.
But you know, the bit the little fight scenes, and like I said, Death by Chimney was fantastic. So
I think though, like the common thing though, I mean, I do like Lads, I'm up in 2 weeks. You know, it was quite a hot mess, but it's quite a hot mess I quite enjoyed. And I think if you're looking for something a bit different for Christmas, you can leave your brain at the door and just enjoy it, then yeah, definitely go and see it, because I think it's definitely worth it.
Yeah,
I was all in. I thought I was sat there with a smile on my face all the way through it.
I hope it does bank. I hope it does bank over fucking Avatar and just pisses all over it, because it was just like absolute fun.
I
fucking hope nothing. No one goes to watch Avatar. I fucking hope that like it makes a quid. All right.
Apparently, it's supposed to be really good.
Oh, fuck off. No, I'd rather watch them. All the I wouldn't watch. I'm not watching any more blue people.
If you want to see some blue people, go and watch Black Panther 2.
I will.
Wakanda Forever.
Or Smurfs.
There's a lot of blue people in that.
But for a fucking Christmas movie and a good Christmas action-y sort of gory sort of movie, it's great. It's not like too much horror in it, elements in it. Just plenty of blood and gore and punching in the face and really inventive, you know, some inventive kills, I suppose. But yeah, not bad. Definitely a good bit of fun just before Christmas. I mean, let's face it, like if we're moving our needle towards the Christmas movie of this year, I think there's one going to be coming on Shudder. So anyway, and then that might shut Paul up.
nothing will shut me up.
But yeah, I don't really think there's that much to talk about on this one, to be honest. It's sort of just like, you know, kicky punchy, just a good bit of fun.
It is good.
Well,
fun.
Look, I mean, the sequel should be John Leguizamo as brother takes out revenge on Santa Claus and goes to the North Pole and lays siege against him.
Without a doubt.
Yeah. Nice. If they do that, 10 out of 10. Fucking yeah. Right.
Murders Mrs. Claus, takes out the elves.
No, he doesn't murder Mrs. Claus. Mrs. Claus is Lily Allen.
What?
She can do the soundtrack as well.
Fair play, yeah. Wait, you see the murderer, yeah.
She can do the soundtrack as well.
Why Lily Allen? Have I missed something with Lily Allen?
David Harbour.
Married to David Harbour.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Okay.
Yeah. Do you want to rate it then?
Yeah, fuck it. That might have been a short review.
Let Paul go first.
Well, lads, I loved it. I'm giving it a 9 out of 10. I absolutely loved it from start to finish. And I get what you're saying, and I kind of agree with you, but I fucking loved it. I can look past that because I was thoroughly entertained. Go out and see it. It's amazing. Yes.
You do like some crap, don't you?
I admire that. It's a 7 for me. It's not too bad. I thought it was... I don't think it deserves a watch. It deserves to go see. It's good fun. Just a few pacing issues for me. That's all.
Yeah, 6 from me. But you're all laughing. But 6 is over halfway. That's like more than a recommendation.
Like a participation award, Matthew. So
I enjoyed it. You. It's good. If David Harbour weren't in it, it probably wouldn't have been as good.
Well, I guess who's getting a fucking bag of coal for Christmas? And it ain't me.
Nice. So if I could do some quick maths, I think
it's 9 out of 10.
I think it makes it about a 7 in the middle. So I draw a nice breath, 7 out of 10 for Violent Night. Oh, that was a quick discussion. Okay, that's fine. Next time we might be pulling something apart a little bit more, because we're going to watch the Joe Bigos on Shudder Christmas Bloody Christmas. Robot Santa Claus, here we come.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, let's hope for another VFW, shall we? All right. Okay, let's move on to our Something to Scream About.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Okay, so this episode's Something to Scream About. We have gone delving deep for our favourite jump scares. So I think we're going to go around. I think we'll do one each. We're going to do 3 each, but then we'll do 1, and then I'll go, and then somebody else go. Yeah? Should we do it like that way? Like we normally do?
Yeah.
Yeah. Go on then, Geordie Paul. Sock it to us. What you got?
Right, well, in number three in my jump scares isn't really a horror film. Sorry, boys.
I don't know if you can do this.
But
we'll have to beat us.
Well, there's scary bits in it, but let's see. Let's see if he's allow it. But number three is a scene from Jurassic Park.
Yeah, you can have that.
All right. Well, so when Ellie's Dr. Sattler goes to look for Samuel L. Jackson's character and she turns the power on, and then she turns around and goes, "Mr. Hammond, we're back in business." And then that fucking raptor just jumps through the fence behind her. That I remember going to say that in the cinema whenever it was out. Fucking hell. Show me age. And it scared me then, and it still makes me jump now. I still know it's coming, and it makes me jump. Every time I see it, I'm like, oh, Jesus. I think I know exactly when the raptor's going to come out, and I never get it right. And yeah, so that's... It's up there. I was just thinking about like times I've been to the cinema or watched a film and it's really made us jump. So definitely that one.
You know Samuel Jackson in that movie?
Yeah.
He's harmless, isn't he?
Oh, dearie me. That's two bags of coal this Christmas.
Oh, Butch, you go next, mate. That's a good one. Love it.
All right. I'm going to drop in because this is sort of a theme, really, because like this is the sort of thing that always creeps me out, and it just suddenly I know I'll expect it, but it'll still come out of fucking nowhere. So I'm gonna start with The Descent, and I'm gonna start where they're all in that fucking tunnel and they're panning around. It's that green night vision, panicked, lost. Suddenly it pans around a couple of times and then boom, the fucking pale monster's behind their fucking shoulder, and you're like, what the fuck? Every single time, night vision, it gets me. It really fucking gets me. I just can't. I know it's going to come, but they suddenly get that beat and they get that the noise right. And it's like I'm usually a gargle, but that little pale fucker, man.
The thing about that scene as well is that it's quite a long time until you get to that. So there's loads of build up and loads of they're going down potholes and going down little bits and tunnels and for ages. And you just know something's going to happen. I think that's what makes it the suspense and the drawn out up to that bit. That's what makes it even more like, oh my God, you get finally see it. It's like, oh shit. It really does. Yeah, it really was a jump scare, wasn't it?
Big time. Big time.
Good go pick. On, Matt. I'm going to go with The Poltergeist. And for me, and this is probably when I was a kid, and this is what made me jump every time. And it even made me jump when I went to the cinema last month to watch it, is The Clown. When the little kid's on the bed and he basically looks and you think, oh, fuck, the clown's under the bed, the clown's under the bed, the clown's under the bed, don't look under there. He looks under there and there's nothing. And he comes back up and the clown's fucking right behind him and then fucking strangles the fuck out of him. But that bit is just like, it's just so loud. And and it's a creepy fucking clown as well. But that just always stuck in my brain when I was a kid, like watching that. But yeah, awesome.
Totally agree.
Back around to Geordie Paul.
Right. This my second one is a piece of genius filmmaking, to be honest. And it's from Paranormal Activity 2.
I had this on my list.
100%. So... obviously you set up from the first Paranormal Activity, which again is a brilliant piece of filmmaking, whereby, you know, it locks you in to looking at things that maybe aren't even there. You're looking for some things that move, that don't move, when it's just locked into one camera position. And obviously then it's mixed with trying to get through the exposition to get back to that bedroom scene. And it's always at night and it's always locked in. And the thing Paranormal Activity 2 does really, really well is it starts with that format, and obviously you've got multiple cameras dotted around the house. So you settle into the rhythm of the film, whereas I'm going to watch them faff on the daytime, but the real juicy stuff's going to happen at night. Until this film, when she's in the kitchen, just going about a normal day, and you're sort of switching off a bit going, well, nothing's going to happen. And your senses are sort of primed for the night. And then all of a sudden, bang! All the cupboards fly open, all the utensils drop off. She absolutely shits herself. It's one of the biggest jumps I've ever had, ever watching a film. And I just thought it was done so well. And they didn't overdo the date. They didn't do it again. They didn't try it and It was that one. And then what it did was put you on edge for the rest of the whole film. Because you think, shit, I have to watch this intently now.
That's the rotary cam, right? The one on the fan.
No,
not that one.
No, this is the second one. We went to the cinema to watch this, Paul, and we fucking shit ourselves.
Oh yeah, I remember.
We weren't expecting it because, like Paul said, it was the day, and they didn't really have it in the day at all. This was the first one that had something really happen in the day. Obviously, it's only the second one, but I do believe they do use that trick in the third as well. I think the third is the rotary cam when it goes back and forth. But yeah, I shit my pants so much because it's so fucking loud.
Yeah, really loud, and just like I said, and you'd spend like, you'd almost go, oh, we don't need to watch the film during them mid bits. Or you sort of giggle and you go, Jesus, did you see? And you end up talking about the night bits. And then it just, like I said, then you thought, shit, I can't talk through this film. I have to concentrate on every bit of it.
Because when it goes to day is when you can breathe and you're like,
yeah.
Wow, we've got through that bit. Now we're going back to night. Oh, no.
Great bit of filmmaking. So yeah, that was my second one.
Awesome.
Well, I think this one is like another one with night vision, use of night vision, use of a video camera, use of like the stuff you can't see and the stuff you see suddenly. Always gets me. Wreck, and it's the fucking boy in the loft. And they used it for, you know, it's the inspiration before Host as well. They did a little thing during COVID, which they scared the shit out of everyone with that. But it's so naughty, like just like literally pops up loft and crawling around, and it's so dark and constricted, you can't see shit. They're using the camera to see, and then suddenly it's there straight away. And it's I don't even know if it lends itself to music at the time to sort of do a sudden, you know, that sort of string beat. It's just boom, fuck, what was that? Oh shit. Yeah, that fucking shit me up big time watching that one. It still does now. It's fucking horrible.
The great thing about Wreck, though, it's basically such a nerve-shredding film all the way through it. And then right at the end, it sort of slows it right down. And it's like, ooh, right, now she's away from everything. She's escaped, like, the zombies from downstairs. And now it's like, oh, and it slows it down. But actually what she's walked into is the worst thing in the fucking
world. The worst situation.
Yeah. Oh, God. And, like, the dragon bit at the end is just fucking just brilliant. It's one of my favourite ever horror films, Wreck. I'll recommend it to anyone who wants to watch horror films, because I love it. I think it's amazing.
Yeah, cracking job. Cracking.
Awesome. Okay, so it's back to me. So I'm going to pick, because I've had to scrub off Paranormal Activity 3 kitchen scene. I'm going to go with Drag Me to Hell. There's one bit, and I remember watching this in the cinema. Butch, we went to see this in the cinema. There's one bit that involves, it's kind of a sleep sequence bit where she's in bed and she's dreaming, and she wakes up coughing, and then literally she's waking up coughing, it's all silent, and then she looks to the left and bang, that old woman from the fucking parking lot is back in her bed, and then fucking pukes up loads of bugs all over her face. And the initial thing where the woman's in the bed is just so fucking loud again, because the music with the woman just bang, and you just think, oh my God, she's there. And then she pukes on her. It's disgusting.
They use that camera shot of like suddenness in that movie so well. They did. It's sort of the similar one in the car as well, where she just, it goes and boom, she's there, and then she's gumming her fucking cheek.
But it's weird. Like, the thing is, it's like they use loads of practical effects, which is even better, which I thought was great. I mean, it's like, you know, that fucking Jesus Christ, it's just that's a big jump scare, man.
I think it's a decent movie, man. I really,
oh, yeah, it's brilliant.
Some proper chills in it.
Really good. Really Sam good. Raimi, you know.
Justin Long, was it? Is it Justin Long as well? Was he the boyfriend?
I can't remember.
Some reason I think it's Justin Long. I don't know why.
Go on, Mr. Stevens. Back to you.
Okay, cool. You just might have this one on your list. I'd be surprised if you didn't. But
I think I left this one because I knew you'd have it. But I wanted you to.
Maybe not.
Oh.
And I picked this because no matter how many times I watched the film, it always makes me jump because I always forget what's happening. So it is the blood test scene from The Thing.
Yeah.
So whenever I watch it, and I'm still now thinking, who is The Thing in this scene? who is the monster? And do you know what? Every time you watch it, it sucks you in and goes, I couldn't 100% tell you who the thing is because I might be wrong. And it's such a magical, I don't know, I mean, you guys probably remember, but I don't. And every time I watch it, I'm going, shit, I can't remember who the monster is. And it's just the tension, the whole tension. They're all tied up on the seat. And he's going around with a little petri dish and he's touching the blood to see if it reacts to the heat. Oh, my God. And every time it's like, oh, you're fine. Oh, you're fine. And they're looking and they're almost like, well, and, you know, it's almost misdirecting you to somebody. And then all of a sudden he just touches it and it goes, bruh! It like flies out tentacles. And then there's that like transformation scene and they're all, there's sort of little comedy element where they're all tied to the bench going,
yeah,
get rid of it, get help, help, help. It's so good. And like, because like I said, I always forget, I get sucked into the tension that much, I forget who the thing is at that time.
The fucking good thing about that scene as well, I love it because when that thing shrieks out of the fucking petri dish, I love the blood on the floor. It's like the blood's walking. It's fucking mental.
It's so cool. It's so good. Such a great, like, tense scene. I mean, it just builds it, builds it, builds it, then flashes, and then all shit hits the fan. It's so good. So, yeah, that was my sort of number one.
Awesome, man.
I've just had a horrible thought as well. It's like, I know I've got that on Blu-ray signed by John Carpenter, and now I can't fucking remember where it is.
lost it.
Sure.
Precious
you
memories.
You probably get a jump scare when you find it.
I'm sure I would have put it somewhere very special in the movie, and now I can't fucking remember where it is. So, because I want to dig that out and watch it. Great fucking pick, man. I'm going to go for not a night vision one this time, but I'm going to go for like a mirror one. So, ooh, you know, that whole trope of like, you know, suddenly it's in a mirror behind you. It's the one with The Conjuring with Farmiga. Vera Farmiga, and she's just going through the little ding 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 ding, and it's the circle of one in the first Conjuring. There's a good cup, to be fair, that whole movie, there's loads of like jump scares in that one you could pick, but like it's just that one where it just moves back, boom, and they use the sound very cleverly in that moment because you know something's going to happen, you know it's there, she knows she can see, and it's just any minute, but it still fucking manages to he's so good, James Wan, in his like filmmaking, just to be able to still sort of drop the sound completely and then bang, hits you again, and it's like fucking bastard, goosebumps everywhere. And it still gets me, like watching that movie again and again. Love it. Ugh.
Well, I'm astounded. I'm astounded about you two not picking this next one.
Well, you're about to see it. Can I guess?
Yeah, go on.
You're about to see Ben Gardner's head in Jaws.
Absolutely 100%. Like every time, like you think you're ready for it, right? We me and Butch went and saw it outside cinema, and they provided headphones so the locals can obviously hear it. So the headphones are quite loud, and I knew that was coming. I knew it was coming, but every time I fucking shit my pants. And it's so cool. It's so good because the build up to it, you just like, all you're thinking is that fucking shark's gonna bust out any second. Like, and again, there's other bits, obviously, the famous chum scene off the side of the boat, that fucking shit me up as well at the same time. But the head thing is just like, you just can't remember exactly when it's going to happen. And when it does, fucking hell, shit myself. The music that goes with it, because it's so quiet, you know, it's serene, it's underneath the water, and then bang, it's like...
Well, that's the thing, if you watch it, Matt, like, well, I saw it in 3D, and... it was really good. Not Jaws. Oh my God. I'm never gonna live that down. It's honestly, it's unreal in 3D. Go watch it in 3D. But when you watch it, the music, the Jaws music's playing, which obviously when you watch the film and you understand it, the shark is there. The shark's around somewhere. So the tension, you know that it's, you think, shit, something's about to happen here. And like you said, Matt, it's that build. It was similar to, you know what's coming, you know what's coming, you know what's coming. But you can never, because I think you get that reaction every time. You spend more, your body sort of spends more time trying to process that reaction.
Getting ready,
the timing of the scene. Yeah. So every time you do it, you go, it's coming, it's coming. Ah!
Do you know what? I cannot wait to sit down with one of my kids and watch this. Just for that moment, because I'm going to be watching them, not the screen. And I'm going to make sure it's fucking loud.
The weeks of nightmares afterwards. But there's a really funny story with Spielberg that he, when the release Jaws, he was a bit unsure of how it would all go, because remember, like, I don't want to go too far in the Jaws, but he wanted more shark in it, and he was a bit worried about that audiences were going to want more monster and all the subtlety of it was going to be lost. And he went into a test screening with a full audience. And that scene, everyone screamed and jumped and shouted, and, you know, like Americans do with the cinema. But he knew after that scene that he was on to a winner. And that's the scene that convinced him that Jaws was going to be a success. And obviously,
well, wicked.
Best history. So, yeah. Unreal. But yeah, I just thought it was a bit obvious, Matt. I thought you guys might have picked it.
No, that's why I left it off my list. But I've got to give some honourable mentions, because obviously I would have picked Alien with the viaduct, like when they're in the duct system and the trackers going off. And it's just the build-up to that. Because, again, it's a bit like Descent. You don't see it for ages and ages. And then suddenly you just see his hands come up. Like that fucking, that's fucking jump scary. You got any honourable mentions?
The Exorcist. I've watched it about 20 times. Where she just, you think she's tied to the bed, and he, Father Karras is like laid, sat there, and all of a sudden she just appears behind him and smacks him. Oh, God.
I mean, classics and Psycho and stuff like that. And, Texas Chainsaw Massacre with the grandpa. And even when he's like suddenly peers out of nowhere with a chainsaw, that's fucking this nuts. But yeah, for me, it's like, consistently in movies that get me, it's the cat or the bird. It's not the monster. It's not the fucking thing. It's just a cat.
Dogs.
A cat jumping into a scene, or a fucking bird fluttering its fucking wings. That get me all day. It's the lead up jump scares that sort of tend to get me.
One that really fucking scared me, that I really wanted on my list, but I just couldn't get there, was the bit in Signs when the alien walked by. That fucking put hair on my... It was more or less of a jump scare and more probably hair on my neck. That was fucking freaky.
It is freaky, man.
Really, really. Vamos, get out of the way, kids. Vamos.
The Sixth Sense got a couple of jump scares in as well.
Yeah. Is that the girl with the pukey face under the blanket?
Girl with the pukey face, yeah.
Pukey face girl.
God, no. Oh. Final Destination, the bus scene. Fucking always brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, there's always a good like someone getting run over by a truck or something. Do you know what I mean? Always. There's always that vehicle jump scare as well. That's like,
watch out for those trucks. I just get out of there. Right, are we all jump scared out anymore? For any more?
Yeah. All scared.
Terrified now.
Terrified. Brilliant. Right then, it's time to move on to our movie from the vault.
This is the road to Potter's Bluff. Maybe you've been there. Clean, picturesque, full of old-fashioned friendliness. The kind of town everyone likes to visit. This is the road to Potter's Bluff. There is no road out.
Welcome to Potter's Bluff.
From the creators of Alien, Terror, brought down to Earth, dead and buried.
Is there any way whatsoever to reanimate people after they have died? To get them to walk around?
That guy, the one you came to see me about last week, wanted to die after the car wreck.
Yeah.
I just saw him.
Man, he's dead! It's the same guy!
Welcome to Potter's Bluff.
When you die, you expect to remain dead and buried.
You had a very close call. Just lie still. I'm gonna give you something. It's gonna make you feel even better.
When you die in Potter's Bluff, expect the unexpected. From the creators of Alien, dead and buried. It will take your breath away. All of it. Dead and buried.
Okay, so this week's movie from the vault was my pick. And I decided to do a bit of fan service to Paul and Matt by coming out of my comfort zone, trolling through Shudder, and finding something from the 80s. So I picked 1981's Dead and Buried. So I'll just give you a quick synopsis. I think I did it last week, but I'll do it again for those who forgot. In Potter's Bluff, unsuspecting visitors are being brutally murdered by groups of locals. But when the sheriff starts to investigate, he uncovers a dark conspiracy involving voodoo, witchcraft, and his own wife.
Whoa.
So, lads, did you enjoy this one? Now, bear in mind, if you slag this too much, right, and slag the fact that I've picked it, I am never picking a fucking shitty 80s film ever again. So just tread carefully. What did you think, honest?
I mean, I thought, like, it could have been, you know, what we did before, the From Beyond and, like, all that sort of stuff, like Stuart Gordon, obviously you know how well it's done when it's done properly. It was just slow, mundane, boring. Didn't really care about what was going on, and some of the twist, but there was an element of it. Okay, the twists were quite interesting. Didn't see it coming. Didn't see that coming, which is quite interesting, maybe because I just lost my thought process of even watching the goddamn thing. It's a bit drab, you know. Special effects were great. Some of the, you know, what they're setting on fire, the murders and all that sort of stuff, and even that like weird sort of makeup thing, but. And the, but the concept's great. It's like effectively a zombie movie, I suppose. Who zombies who like taking photos of people. So there you go. That's how I describe this movie. Zombies with zombies with cameras. So there you go, Matt.
Well, you're completely wrong. I'm sorry, mate. I fucking love this film. I thought it was absolutely brilliant. Probably one of the best movies from the vault I've probably seen this year. I'm not joking. I thought it was brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. I loved it from the fucking start. Just that start opening scene is fucking crazy. It's just like, what? I did not see that coming. Like some guy who's obviously new to the place and the locals are just fucking batshit crazy, just decide to fucking beat the crap out of him, put him in a fucking fishnet and set him on fire. Which the fucking effects were brilliant throughout this movie. It's just a masterclass of effects. I fucking loved it. And it, what makes this better is the fucking grandpa from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Fucking amazing. His character was brilliant.
He was died a week.
Top notch, mate. That is top notch acting right there because he was brilliant. I fucking loved it. I absolutely loved this movie.
Wow.
I'm going to buy it, mate. I'm going to fucking buy the shit out of that when I get hold of a copy.
It's on Shudder, mate, for free.
I want to own it. I want to own it. I want to know all everything about it. I just thought it's one of those things where I've never actually watched it. I've never even seen the cover in the video shop when I was a kid. It probably was there somewhere. I don't know.
It's a fucking boring poster and all. It's a boring poster.
You're wrong.
A boring start.
You've never been so wrong.
Such an awful, like, slow, mundane start. Fair enough, they beat the shit out of him, but he gets lured in by some lady in red. But so boring throughout. It's like, God.
Sorry, you're wrong. For the one time, you're wrong. I don't know if you're in the wrong frame of mind of watching it. Maybe you were tired, I don't know. But, mate, I love this movie. Okay. So, do you know what I thought when I was watching it as well? I thought, I think Butch is going to really like this one. It really is. Like, there's so much good stuff about it. Sorry, I've been going on so long. Geordie Paul, what did you think? You
picked it. I just got to weigh in somewhere sort of in the middle because I agree with Butch for the start. I was a bit like, oh, will you just get on with will something happen? And I sort of felt I was watching a bit of a TV film. Do you know what I mean? Like at one point, I was like, is this an episode of Columbo or something?
But I love that. I love the suspense because that's the whole point. It's just like, who the fuck is that? Who is she? Is my own fucking wife fucking me over? And it's just like, we'll get on to the end in a bit where I feel that they've missed the trick. But that's the whole point.
Well, so by the end of it, I actually quite enjoyed it because I agree with Butcher, though, with the concept. I think there's a better film to be made with the concept. Like, I really do. But I thought the kills were great. I thought the special effects, the acid dripping into someone's face and all the skin bubbling up. And I know, Paul, you touched on it, the mortuary scene. where he sort of stripped her back and put her back together again. I thought it was really,
the reconstruction scene was fucking awesome. That was a masterclass in like special effects. It was just, that was insane. The way it must have took so long to do. I thought it was fantastic.
I spent the film going, oh no, they're gonna miss a trick. I don't know what trick you say they missed for the end, Martin. We'll talk about it. And I was hoping, I was like, they're not gonna do it, and I wish they did. But actually, they did to what I was thinking, and I thought it was quite cool. But yeah, so we'll just rein it back for the plot. So it's basically, there's a town called Potter's Bluff, and there's a couple of grisly murders happening, and the detective, the chief of police, or the sheriff or whatever, is investigating these murders, and he's not quite happy with how they're going on. He's trying to get, obviously, all the townsfolk. It's one of them towns where everyone knows everyone, and you have the creepy mortuary man, who Matt said is Grandpa from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
He's very, very eccentric, isn't he? He's very, there's something about him is just a bit weird.
Treats his like sort of patients or victims or whatever, like as art subjects, and is very, very sort of particular in how he does it. And all the while, like you said, these randomers are getting bumped off by people in the town folk and taking photos.
I think it's because, like, it's very H.P. Lovecraft in its approach, but it didn't deliver in the same way that, like, what we've been watching recently, and like From Beyond and like Reanimator. You know, it's that sort of like, I guess maybe I've just become attuned to the whole wackiness and the beam.
Did you want a bit more tongue in cheek, Paul?
You know me, I love a bit of tongue in cheek. Like, I didn't.
Yeah. Not the
seriousness of it sort of didn't gel. Maybe I've just watched serious horror movie in such a long time.
It's on that cusp of, remember, it's like, it's still, this film is, for me, I think, as watching it, it's still very 70s. It's very TV-esque.
For the sheriff's wife, do you know who the sheriff's wife is?
No.
She's the female lead in Flash Gordon.
That's it. I knew it was her. I thought for ages, I thought the dad, because he looked a bit like him, it looked a bit like the dad from The Wonder Years.
Yeah.
It's not him.
He looked like Johnny Cash, to be honest. That was Cash, is it?
I thought he was great. I thought he was really good.
So you find out basically he is getting closer and closer to sort of the truth, and then shock horror, you find out that the people that have been killed start reappearing in the town, as if they've always been there.
Yeah, that was, again, that was lost on me a little bit for quite a while. I was like realizing that some of the things that I wrote down on here, I'm like, it was really lost on me, because I didn't even know what happened to the family. Did they die?
No, they got away.
You must have not watching it.
They got away.
They basically, may I add, we didn't even talked about this. Freddy Krueger drags them out of the fucking river and says, I pulled a car out of the river. Like, and it was their car.
Yeah, I knew it was their car, so I didn't really know what happened to them.
They'd obviously been like pushed off the road and died.
Yeah.
Money, mate. It's budget. Come on. Got to have some off-screen kills.
You know, but she was quite... But
yeah, I agree. That's a bit weird.
It's a bit weird where they all came from in the end. But again, like zombies, they just come out of nowhere, you know, with cameras, and beat the shit. Maybe not enough.
The reason they're taking the pictures, Paul, is because they're catching the mortician. He likes... So basically you find out that he's basically rebuilding them, and he's found a way through witchcraft. And it really goes into that sort of the method of it, but of reanimating the corpses. And what he does is he makes them sort of better, or a newer version of themselves. But in order to do that, they need to die grisly deaths. Now, I don't know whether that's to do with... You know, he takes photos of them at their like worst, essentially. Like, they're scared.
He liked having a job.
Well, I thought it was moving into like sort of an exploitation movie at first. And I thought, okay, I was kind of like, maybe this could be good. But then it sort of pulled its way back. But there were some sort of like exploitation, because this was considered a video nasty at the time as well. And I guess that was because of some of the elements they've done. There are some violent bits, but it wasn't violent enough for me. I think
pouring acid into someone's mouth and nose and making their face collapse is not grisly enough.
It didn't really do it for me enough. Like it that scene could have been
smashing someone up with rocks and then setting them alight.
Too not good in enough. It seemed too in the middle. It didn't go far enough to disturb or the other way to sort of make it a little bit more campy.
That's your opinion, isn't it? If you like
that is my opinion.
Camp horror is your thing, mate. You know, that's cool.
So we get he finds out that his wife's like being hired and stuff and is in on the conspiracy, and then he sort of finds out and confronts the old dude, and then you realize that they're all dead. And he's been sort of bringing them back to life and touching them up. So I think that's why they're killing people, is to make sure it's like he's blackmailing them to go, well, I'll keep sort of touching yous up and like reapplying your skin. Because obviously towards the end, all their skin's starting to come away and fall apart.
Do you think they know? They know they're dead, right? So, but he controls them all. So has he got any conscious thought? Because the wife's dead.
I think they're sort of saying like be happy for her because she's escaped, because basically he buries her and she wants to be buried because she gets shot, and I don't know if that sort of her into sort of
a mortal wound. But is she dead alive or is she fully dead? Is she gonna
I don't think they can die again. I think that's it, they're all alive, but I think they're living like in hell. I think that because the girl says to him, be happy, she's like a lucky one, or she's escaped, or she's happy now or something. And they're all sort of just staying alive. I don't know whether they have to stay alive or they're being controlled to stay alive, and they all want like release from it.
Mm.
But they're definitely not all self-aware, because otherwise the detective would know. Spoilers. Ooh.
Yeah, the triple spoiler at the end or something like that was.
Well, I didn't think they were going to do it. So basically, I was sat there thinking, do you know what would be great? It'd be great if he like destroys them all and gets away, and then realizes that he's dead too.
That's a good one, but I felt the better ending would have been a bit of a more kind of morbid ending, would have been that he just goes so insane that he actually kills his wife, but kills her because she's real and she had nothing to do with it, and then realizes that he's actually dead, but he's killed his wife.
And then she comes back to life at the
end.
I
just thought that would have been a bit more harrowing that that's why they switched it from me, because I was like, he's definitely going to kill her and she's not going to be one of them, because the whole way through it he's adding it all up and he's like, she's one of them. And then literally obviously the reveal at the end, the double bluff kind of thing, which I thought was quite clever.
The shocker. By the way, it's your wife who's dead. But by the way, you're also dead.
But they were never husband and wife. It was she killed him after they were having sex, and she killed him during sex. So it was just a body. Yeah. So he's been given this like backstory or being programmed or whatever it is to think that he's the policeman.
This is why throughout the whole film, I was trying to put two and two together with, like, they're all talking like he's been away, and become something great and come back to the island. When it is not, he's never left, and it's like, now it makes sense, because surely, you know, that they'd all be like killing him because he's not really from there. But you know, they don't really talk about his past much.
Yeah,
and then his wife being there as well, it's like, surely he came back from where he's been with his wife, but obviously he's been there the whole time.
But I agree, Butch, that there's definitely like there's definitely work to do on the concept.
I think it's a little modernized it.
And like added a bit, you know, like Truman Show-esque type of stuff. I think you could make a fucking stupendous film.
I agree. There's a good movie there. It's weird as well, because like 118 episodes. I know like we didn't see eye to eye on a couple of them, like The Gate and Nightbreed, but they're ones you'd seen before. This is the first one we both haven't seen. So far apart. Crazy. 118.
Yeah, you're wrong for a third time.
Not wrong, it's an opinion.
Absolutely.
Mine is I nearly fell asleep watching the bastard. So
I don't think you're in the right frame. I think you need to go back, rewind it.
I'm not wasting another hour
after
my life.
Don't work whilst watching movies.
Honestly,
at the start, I was like, oh my God, I'm going to get mullered in this podcast. Because
I loved it. Because I thought it was so fucking so weird. I was like, this is awesome. I really didn't know where this film was going.
It wasn't weird enough for me.
I love being challenged. Like, what the fuck is going on here?
It was not weird enough for me.
I've not seen anything. It's like similar to this.
Why didn't anything come from the sea? Right, they're by the, you know, and start raping the whole town is what I would understand. I don't really understand.
Needs more giant octopuses. Mega sharks.
Octopuses with pussies.
Yeah.
But that's good, though, that we all sort of disagree and agree, and makes for a better conversation, gents.
Makes a change when Matt's wrong. That's funny.
I really thought you would have liked this one. I'm gobsmacked. I really am, because I just thought the weirdness, the kills were good, the you know, practical effects, and just the whole crazy bonkers of it all. I thought Butch definitely gonna. That's why I thought you were like kidding at the start. Like, I thought, wow, he's like. Is he double bluffing? Because I'm double.
I thought you were kidding.
Stan Winston did the practical effects as well.
He did a fucking great job.
Hey, I'm not mocking the effects of it all.
I didn't say you were. Great.
But just the whole me. Just boring. Well,
are we going to hear some maths facts? Did you get any?
Oh, yes, I've got some maths facts, yeah. I'm going to make them extra long just to piss Paul off even more. I'm going to pick all the really, really long ones. Like to read out and make. And should I do it in a boring voice as well? Just to make him even.
Oh, that'll be a change.
Now he's getting personal because he's upset. Right, here we go. So, this was Jack Albertine's final theatrical film. Paul, you'll be glad to hear that, Butch. Although he filmed another made-for-television movie the same year he died, in poor health and suffering from cancer all through filming. Albertson passed away a few months after this movie's release. He nonetheless lived long enough to see its world premiere in Hollywood, in which he attended in a wheelchair with an oxygen tank and a mask. So at least he got to watch it. Yeah. Stan Winston's special effects went beyond creating gore for the film. The figure in the full body cast lying in George LeMond's hospital bed was a mechanical dummy built by Winston. The lifelike detail, elaborate movements, the dummy was rigged to make, gives the appearance that it's a real person, and makes infamous needle eye stab, which we didn't even cover. Another gruesome thing. That eye stab was insane, and I didn't even know that. I thought that was a real person in there. That's how good that was.
Yeah, the putting the eyeball into the head was pretty.
Yeah, that was grim. That was grim. During filming, director Gary Sherman purposely avoided letting the colour red be visible in any scene, so the sight of blood during the murder sequences would be more shocking. Sherman even went as far as to have the taillights of vehicles replaced with purple lights instead of normal red, which is quite cool. In 1983, an interview with Starburst promoting Blue Thunder from 1983, Dan O'Bannon is connected to this film. Obviously, you know who he is. Disowned this movie, claiming that Ronald Shusett had actually written it by himself, but needed O'Bannon's name on the project, promising he would implement some of O'Bannon's changes. Upon seeing the finished film, O'Bannon realised that Shusett hadn't included his material, but it was also too late for him to take his name off the credits. I'll just do one more, because this one's quite a long one. It's quite funny. The most extensive effect in the movie was the reconstruction of the hitchhiker played by Lisa Marie. Once she was killed, again, we did a lot of really fun in-camera tricks and slides and moves. But the first image we see of her lying on the mortician's table is this completely destroyed face. Of course, it was a puppet's head, recreation of her eyes and the destroyed look. I started with the live cast of Lisa Marie, then I created a clay replica. Then I started literally carving away at the face section by section. Since I had all the original casting of her skin, I was able to actually take a final skin and layer over the entire puppet. Stan explained, I call it the puppet because what I added layer by layer was the skull, the muscles and the skin, and it all came back together to recreate Lisa Marie. I was able then to pull the lips back and check the teeth, pull the eyelids back and see the eyes, and then pull the other eyelid back to find the socket was still empty. I thought it was fucking brilliant. And a total of 48 deaths.
Which lips?
Not enough deaths for you, Paul, obviously.
Oh, God. It's sort of like a precursor to the Hellraiser, wasn't it? That sort of like put bad together. So it's kind of gross, but yeah, interesting.
So let's rate it then. What are you going to give it, Paul? Go on, you go first, Paul.
It's not too bad. I'll give it a 4. It's not anything. It's not average for me. It didn't move my needle, but a 4 out of 10 for the special effects alone, defo.
Cool. Well, actually, I'm going to give it a 7. Because I came away at the end of it thinking, bloody hell, I actually quite enjoyed that. And I at the start, I was like, this is going to be horrendous. What have I done? And actually, at the end, I thought, Jesus, that was quite good. So yeah, a 7. But I definitely think there's somebody should take this and remake it. And it could be something unreal. So yeah, so 7 out of 10 for me. Matt?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I'd say it's like, it could, the ending felt a tiny bit rushed at the end. So for me, it's not quite a 9, but it probably will be after I watch it again. But I'd say an 8 for me. But I thought it was brilliant. I thought it was really good. I just thought, like you said, if somebody took this and just ironed out a few bits, it could be really, really cool and interesting. But I don't know if that ship has sailed because of the kind of timing of it, of when it was made. But yeah, I just thought it was really cool. I really enjoyed it because it was just different, and I like seeing new stuff. And, you know, and when we get a new things that we've not seen, and I wasn't really, you know, when you said about it, I was like, I'm not seeing it, but I'm so glad I have now. So great pick. Well done.
Well, I wanted to see it, and it got lost on me, obviously, a little bit. But with my average 4, it's brought it down to about 6 out of 10. So
7 out of 10, but yeah, you can't do maths. But
I added them up and divided by 3, so 6.3 recurring.
That's so an 8 out of 10.
The maths fails you.
The thing is, if you read the Shudder reviews on it as well, it's polarizing on Shudder reviews as well. I know some of the Shudder reviews are fucking stupid, but still, it's quite a polarizing. Some people like love it, some people hate it, some people love it. There's not a lot of middle ground there, so yeah. One of them films.
Interesting. Phil. Very interesting.
So I will stay picking 80s films then.
So it's down to Mr. Boucher.
All right, then.
I want to be a bit more happy. He's a bit sad. Let's perk it up a little bit, Butch.
I've been wanting to watch this movie for quite some time. I haven't seen it. It's Christmas based. With the theme, I went for this one. There was a couple that I was going to go for. With the theme that we sort of got now with this Violent Night movie and watching Christmas Bloody Christmas, we're going to watch Santa's Sleigh, starring Bill Goldberg. So if Santa was a demon, basically, who lost a bet, and he hasn't, the bet's off, and he fucks you. I don't know. I've seen a lot of trailer, like a lot of snaps of like Santa gone bad, and this is the ultimate Santa gone bad. I think it's from 2005, so it's not that old.
When you say Bill Goldberg, do you mean the wrestler Goldberg?
Yeah, he plays Santa.
2005.
Yeah, haven't seen.
What's this on?
Amazon Prime for free. So it's a freebie, hopefully for Mr. Stevens as well.
Jordy Paul's looking a bit scared there.
I was going to go another year when it's my pick. Eventually, I'm going to go for Jack Frost, which is the raping snowman. I'm going to go for that one year.
Not the Michael Keaton family film, though.
Not the Keaton one, no.
You've got a problem. What did we do last year? What was the one we did last year with the crazy Santa?
Oh, Silent Night, Bloody Night, wasn't it?
That was cool. That was fucking
great. We could have done Silent Night, Bloody Night 2.
next year.
So, but yeah, I think this one is going to be fun because of what we're doing with Joe Bigos. I think this is like quite a good little side piece for it.
Okay, cool.
Yes. Okay, game on, Santa Slay. All right. Episode 118. Done. Moving on to 119. Thank you to everyone for listening. And once again, we are sponsored by Brave Rebel Clothing.
I'll put that in there, mate.
Go buy those t-shirts for Christmas. BraveRebelClothing.com.
You won't get it because it strikes, but never mind. I'm joking.
Matt will hand deliver them. All right, that's what I've been told. Hand deliver them.
Geordie Paul, don't you go ordering any.
Right, so moving on to 119, we will be reviewing the Joe Bigos movie Christmas Bloody Christmas. We will be opening our presents to each other. We've done obviously this is the first year that Mr. Geordie Paul has been involved, so this would be quite funny to see who wins. Well, it's not winning, it's not about winning, it's just about giving.
I think yous are going to be very happy with what yous have got for Christmas.
I'm going to have
to cancel that dead and buried VHS I got for book.
And then our move from the vault, which I've just picked, is 2005 Santa's Sleigh. All right. Well, if there's nothing more to say, when there's no more room in hell, here's another podcast.
I am the devil, and I am here to do the devil's work.
You can follow us on Twitter at @DrawOneLast, Instagram at @DrawOneLastBreath, or pop us an email at @DrawOneLastBreath@hotmail.com.